Very good morning to one and all. I am Ekendra Jupudi, an associate of Yagna Legal Firm and also serving as a central government counsel at High Court of Andhra Pradesh. I am extremely overwhelmed to get this opportunity to welcome you all for today's August gathering, which is hosted by our very own Yagna Legal Firm. We are a legal firm which handles all kinds of litigation under one roof for both the High Courts of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. We, as a team of legal enthusiasts, have been conducting a series of webinars on the topics which are utmost helpful and enlighten the practicing advocates of various courts, tribunals, quasi-judicial bodies, including the Honorable High Courts. Our effort towards the set goal might be small, yet it is sincere and benevolent. I once again heartily welcome all of you for today's August virtual gathering. Now I request Sri Poluri Bhaskar and also Srimati, I would like to introduce Sri Poluri Bhaskar, our senior associate, and Srimati Sridevi Jampani, the founder of the Yagna Legal Firm, to the webinar. I once again convey my best wishes and also gratitude to my Lord Honorable Justice Sitaram Murthy Garu for accepting our invitation, and also Mr. Manish Mohan for accepting our invitation. Now I request Poluri Bhaskar, our senior associate, to take over the platform and introduce the panelists to the participants and as well as about our topic today. Thank you.
My Lord Justice Sitaram Murthy Garu, I take the privilege of introducing His Lordship. This is Mandhar Sitaram Murthy's youngest child of Sri Mandhar Chitana Garu and Srimati Surlakshmi Garu. He was born on 16 January at Kakinada of East Godavari District. He holds a degree in BSc and degree in law, both from Andhra University. He won the gold medal for proficiency in law of torts in the first year of law, apart from other prizes. He hails from a family of lawyers in Kakinada of East Godavari District. He is a third generation lawyer in the hierarchy and had actively practiced for 12 years until his selection as a district judge. On his direct appointment in December 1996 as a district judge grade 2 in the Andhra Pradesh Higher Judicial Services, he had participated in 2-month foundation course for direct recruit district judges in Andhra Pradesh Judicial Academy. He was awarded the best trainee district judge gold medal for the year 1996-97 by the academy. Afterwards, worked as special judge for SP and ACB cases, second additional district judge Nellore, third additional district and sessions judge Kurnool, senior faculty and additional director, Judicial Academy, judge family court, special judge for SP and ACB cases, come third additional district and sessions judge, special judge for CBI cases, metropolitan sessions judge Vishakhapatnam, principal district and sessions judge Vijayanagaram, principal district and sessions judge Rangareddy, and Registrar General of High Court of Andhra Pradesh, Chairman of Sales Tax Appellate Tribunal, Vishakhapatnam, and Chief Judge, City Civil Court, Hyderabad. He is an experienced lawyer and a judge and has also specialized in teaching and training judicial officers and ministerial officers of the courts in the state of Andhra Pradesh. While working as a senior faculty and additional director of Andhra Pradesh Judicial Academy, he had compiled reading and reference material for the various academic programs and in the process had worked with judges of all cadres, academicians, teachers, jurists and faculty, and had compiled teaching material and reference materials in the field of law and allied subjects. He was appointed the additional judge of the High Court of Andhra Pradesh and sworn as additional judge of the High Court on 23-10-2013. He was appointed as judge of High Court of Judicature at Hyderabad for the state of Telangana and the state of Andhra Pradesh and assumed charge as such on the afternoon of 2-3-2016. He was later appointed as judge of the High Court of Andhra Pradesh on 1st January 2019. Laid down the office of the judge of the High Court on 15-1-2020 on attaining the age of superannuation. Assumed charge as chairperson Andhra Pradesh State Human Rights Commission on 24th March 2021. He is married to Mrs. Srimata and couple is blessed with a daughter, Ms. Shrutakirti, and son, Master M.S. Achyuta. He is passionate in meditation, listening to music, traveling, and spending time with the children. And now I introduce Mr. Manish Mohan, my good old friend, who is also a panelist of this webinar. Mr. Manish Mohan is an advocate practicing in New Delhi. He practices in Supreme Court and as well as he's a senior standing counsel, central government in Delhi High Court. And he's a voracious reader, academician, and also a fine advocate. And in fact, he needs no introduction for those who read his books. He's a very famous co-revising author for Mullah of CPC, CPC Mullah, and also Law of Evidence, Woodruff and Amir Ali. So now I request Justice M. Sitaram Murthy Garu to give valuable address to this webinar.
With the permission of my lord, I would like to make a small representation. I request all the participants to kindly mute their systems while the honorable speakers are delivering, so that in order to avoid the hassle to the honorable speakers. Thank you.
Very good morning, and my regards to all elders. Good wishes and affectionate regards to all youngsters. To begin with, I thank the hosts of this webinar, Sri Bhaskar Poluri, Mr. Sridevi, Mr. Jupudi, respected and learned Manish Mohan, Advocate Delhi, and all other participants for the opportunity given to me to share my views and humble thoughts on the assigned topic, documentary evidence. As we all know, law is an ocean. Its depths are unfathomable. And it has horizons which spread very widely. Therefore, nobody can claim to be a master of law. We are all students of law. Whenever I get an opportunity to interact on subjects of law, I happily agree, because through interactions and teaching, I learn a lot, because I believe teaching is learning. Today's topic is a very vast topic to which a fully equipped expert can devote a lifetime study. And subject to my limitations, I will try to share my humble thoughts on the subject. When we deal with any branch of law, we have to have a comprehensive idea of the gamut of law. Like, for example, when we are talking about documentary evidence, we are supposed to have a bird's eye view of the entire evidence set. Evidence Act has three parts. Part one deals with the relevancy of facts. It has two chapters. The first chapter is preliminary. The second chapter is of the relevancy of facts. Part two, it deals with proof. The heading says on proof. It contains chapters 3, 4, 5 and 6. Chapter 3 deals with facts which need not be proved. Chapter 4 with oral evidence, sections 59 and 60, very important. Chapter 5, documentary evidence, which is relevant for today, sections 61 to 90. And chapter 6, again relevant, exclusion of oral and oral evidence by documentary evidence, sections 91 to 100. Part 3 deals with production effect of evidence, again relevant for today. It consists of chapters 7 to 11. Chapter 7, burden of proof. Here we have to bear in mind the distinction between onus of proof and the burden of proof. Sections 101 to 114. Chapter 8 deals with estoppel. Sections 115 to 117. Chapter 9 deals with competency and comparability of witnesses. Again, relevant when a witness is producing a document. Sections 118 to 134. Chapter 10, examination of witnesses. This is again important because who has to commence and right to adduce evidence is an important aspect. Sections 135 to 166 and chapter 11, improper admission and rejection of evidence. Again, very, very important. Section 167. In this backdrop of the entire gamut of evidence act, we shall now deal with the assigned topic. Be it noted that at the end of the trial, either in a civil case or a criminal case, or a civil proceeding or a criminal proceeding, in my humble view, there may be three kinds of evidence before the court. What are the three kinds? One is oral evidence. The other is documentary evidence. The third is material evidence. Some youngsters may get a doubt as to whether there will be material evidence in a civil proceeding. You know that in a criminal proceeding, the weapon of offense may be a material object. It is material evidence. But when you refer to Order 13, Rule 11 of the Code, it says provisions as to documents applied to material objects. So the provisions therein contained as to documents shall, as far as may be, applied to all other material objects produced. One is relevancy. The other is admissibility, and finally, proof. Proof comes at a later stage, but mode of proof comes while adducing evidence. When we come to mode of proof, we have to also bear in mind, apart from relevancy and admissibility, order of production and examination of witnesses. Who should be examined first? Who should be later examined? On whom the initial onus of proof lies, whether it is for the plaintiff to begin or the defendant to begin? When there are more issues, who has to begin first? Because when there are more issues, on some issues, the onus may be on the plaintiff, and on some other issues, the onus may be on the defendant. So here, some provisions of the CPC, like Order 18 and Order 41, are also relevant because under 41, additional evidence is also adducible. Right. Now, when we are adducing documentary evidence, we should know of what evidence may be given. Unless we know of what evidence may be given, it is impossible to adduce Latin evidence. The rule of evidence is, evidence may be given of facts in issue. The rule of evidence is, evidence may be given of facts in issue. Please see section 3 of the Indian Evidence Act. We use evidence not only of facts in an issue, but also of relevant facts. Please see section 5 and other sections of chapter 2 of the Act. Here, when I am talking about relevancy, there are number of sections of law on this relevancy, right from section 6 to section 55. Therefore, when we are talking of relevancy, the youngsters may note that it is better to group these sections depending upon their category. Like, for example, section 6 to 16 deal with relevancy of facts connected with the facts in issue. That is one group. Section 17 to 31 deal with relevancy of admissions and confessions. Admissions and confessions is again a huge topic. For youngster's sake, we can say illustratively the difference between admissions and confessions. Supposing one person says in a criminal proceeding, I saw her drowning, it is an admission. Another person says, I drowned her to death. It is a confession, because on that statement, a conviction is possible. This is the second group of sections dealing with relevancy. The third group is sections 32 and 33, which deals with relevancy of statements made by persons who cannot be called as witnesses. The fourth group is sections 34 to 39, dealing with relevancy of statements made under special circumstances. Then sections 40 to 44, the fifth group, relevancy of judgments of the courts, very important. Then sections 45 to 51, dealing with the relevancy of opinions of witnesses, opinion evidence. Here, I may bring to your kind notice that witnesses, while giving oral evidence, are giving evidence based on documents, are not supposed to give opinions. It is for the court to formulate an opinion. So witnesses must confine to facts and not state opinions in regard to matters under inquiry. This is a very, very important aspect. Please see AER 1957 Supreme Court 857 Mubarak Ali's case, wherein the Supreme Court said that witnesses must confine to facts and shall not give opinions, and formulation of opinions on the basis of evidence adduced before the court is a judicial function. Now we are coming to the next group, the last group of sections under relevancy, sections 52 to 55, which deal with relevancy of character of parties in civil proceedings. Then here the youngsters may have to bear in mind that facts are of two kinds, because we are talking about giving evidence of facts in issue and also relevant facts. What are those two kinds? Physical facts and psychological facts. Physical facts, I need not tell you, they are perceivable by senses. That means physical facts mean and include anything or state of things or relation of things capable of being perceived by our senses. What are the five senses? We generally, in our classroom, our teachers say easy way to remember: drusya, sravana, sparsha, rasa, gandha. Drusya, the power to see; sravana, hearing; rasa, taste; sparsha, touch; gandha, smell. These are the physical facts. Here, then what is the psychological fact? Psychological facts mean and include anything of which a person is conscious. That means it depends upon the consciousness, like mens rea, the intention to do a particular thing or not to do a particular thing. So these are the important basic things which one has to remember when talking about documentary evidence. Then we will come to who has to begin, who has a right to adduce evidence. That means order of production and examination of witnesses, whether it is oral evidence or documentary evidence. Order 18, Rule 1 speaks about right to begin. It generally says the plaintiff has the right to begin unless the defendant admits the facts alleged by the plaintiff and contends that either in the point of law or on some additional facts alleged by the defendant, the plaintiff is not entitled to any part of the reliefs which the plaintiff seeks, in which case the defendant has the right to begin. Like, for example, in a suit for a promissory note, in suit based on a promissory note, on the foot of a promissory note, the execution is denied, the issue will be whether the suit promissory note is true and valid. The suit promissory note is true and valid, the burden, the initial onus of proof is on the plaintiff. Let us slightly modify the illustration. The suit is based on the foot of a promissory note. The defense is, it is true, it is executed, but the consideration did not pass. The issue will be whether the suit promissory note is not supported by consideration. Because Section 118 of the Negotiable Instruments Act, which deals with a presumption, says that when execution is admitted, the presumption is that the consideration passed. Therefore, in view of this provision of law, which reverses the rule of onus of proof, we include not in the issue but and frame the issue as to whether the suit promissory note is not supported by consideration. When we close the word whether in this issue and read it, the suit promissory note is not supported by consideration, it is an affirmation by the defendant, not by the plaintiff. So he who asserts must prove is the rule of evidence. Therefore, the onus, the initial onus, is on the defendant in that particular illustration. Likewise, the right to begin, the judge must be conscious, because most of the cases get adjourned on the simple argument, on the day the trial is fixed, that the burden is on the other side but not on the plaintiff. For hearing on this aspect, the matters will be adjourned. If the judge is having knowledge of the basics of the law of evidence, then the matter need not be adjourned and the trial can proceed. Take a case I was mentioning earlier, where there are several issues. On some of the issues, the initial onus of proof is on the plaintiff, and on the remaining issues, the initial onus of proof is on the defendant. Then what to do? Please see again Order 18, Rule 3 and Rule 3A. In such cases, the plaintiff has a choice. The plaintiff can adduce evidence initially on the issues on which the initial onus of proof is on the plaintiff and reserve the right to adduce rebuttal evidence on the remaining issues, because on the remaining issues, the initial onus of proof is on the defendant. That is how in the trial court, the parties proceed to adduce evidence depending upon the onus of proof. I am repeatedly referring to onus of proof and burden of proof. In my humble view, onus of proof is the burden to introduce evidence. It is not the legal burden. It is evidentiary burden. Whereas, burden of proof is the legal burden which never shifts. The onus of proof during trial shifts from side to side, but legal burden never shifts. In this connection, I request the youngsters to refer to A. Raghavamma's case, which is a landmark judgment of the Supreme Court dealing with these two important phrases, onus of proof and burden of proof. AER 1964 Supreme Court 136. Then while producing oral or documentary evidence, though we are concentrating today on documentary evidence, the youngsters must bear in mind two aspects. One is standards of proof. The other is the burden of proof. What are the standards of proof? In a civil case, the standard of proof is preponderance of probabilities. Please read section 3. In criminal cases, the standard of proof is proof beyond reasonable doubt. Though the Evidence Act is the same, we have a different standard of proof in criminal cases because of the judgment law. I wish that the juniors, youngsters must read Periyasamy's case in this regard, 1997 Criminal Law Journal 219 Supreme Court. 1997 Criminal Law Journal 219 Supreme Court. And also Sarvan Singh's case, AER 1957 Supreme Court 637. Sarvan Singh's case, AER 1957 Supreme Court 637. I need not tell you the cardinal rules of criminal jurisprudence. The cardinal rules of criminal jurisprudence are also to be borne in mind when a judge is receiving documentary evidence in a criminal case. First principle is presumption as to innocence of the accused. The second is proof beyond reasonable doubt. The third is the burden is always on the prosecution, except in cases where accused pleads general exceptions. Please refer to... Shall I continue?
Yes, sir, please.
Yes, sir. AER 1973 Supreme Court 2773. Right. These are the cardinal rules of criminal jurisprudence. Apart from that, there are certain other principles which run through the cobweb of criminal jurisprudence, which I shall make a passing reference to. Benefit of doubt, right to silence, right of opportunity under section 313 CRPC to explain away incriminating circumstances in the evidence of the prosecution, right to be heard on the measure of sentence in case the accused is convicted, rules of prudence, namely looking for corroboration or assuring material. So all the above features of the criminal law clearly emphasize the need to write just, fair and reasonable trial in all criminal trials. So these are the fundamentals which are to be borne in mind. While dealing with the trial, that is the process of adduction of evidence. Now let us turn to section 59, which says, all facts except contents of documents may be proved by oral evidence. So contents of documents generally cannot be proved by oral evidence. Section 60 says oral evidence must be direct. I already said direct evidence is possible of facts in issue and relevant facts, provided such facts are perceived by the five senses. Then we all know hearsay evidence is inadmissible there are six exceptions, namely religious stay, admissions and confessions, statements made under Section 32 of the Act, evidence given in the former proceeding, statements in public documents, and also please refer to the sixth exception is provisions of provisos of 1 and 2 of Section 60. The judge has to also bear in mind these aspects when evidence is being adduced. Superiority of written proof, oral, verbal proof needs no emphasis. Superiority of written proof, that means documentary evidence, oral, verbal proof, that is oral evidence, needs no emphasis. Now, documentary evidence. Documents can be filed at what stages? This is very, very important for a judge. One, for the plaintiff, the documents must be filed with the pleadings. For the defendant, the documents must be filed with the written statement within the time permissible under law. But in between, in my view, there is another stage of filing documents. Supposing the plaintiff files an interlocutory application and obtains an ex parte order, the defendant has got 90 days time to file his written statement. But before that time, he wants the interim order to be vacated. Therefore, within 15 days of the granting of the interim order on receipt of the interim order, he files an application to vacate the order and also a counter in the interlocutory application. At that stage, the defendant is entitled to file documents. So in between stage, the defendant will be filing documents subject to his right to file documents along with the written statement. So these are the three stages. Then if any document is omitted to be filed, document can be filed with the leave of the court. Then there is another stage at which documents can be filed. That is, document can be confronted to a witness during the cross-examination stage. That document need not be filed along with the pleadings or at any prior stage. Straight away, a document can be confronted to the witness. What kinds of documents can be confronted to the witness? Any document which the witness is concerned with can be confronted to the witness. Here, I would like the youngsters to read two important cases, namely Salem Advocate Bar Association cases 1 and 2. Wherein the amendments of the CPC were beautifully analyzed and reports are submitted by Honorable Sri Justice Mamidanna Jagannath Rao Garu to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court considered those reports in extenso and then dealt with the amendments which are valid and which are not valid. AER 2003 Supreme Court 189, AER 2005 Supreme Court 3353. Here, two important orders of the CPC, Order 7 and Order 8 are relevant. Please read Rule 14.4, Rule 14.4 and also Rule 1A.4 of Order 8. So this is how documents are filed. Documents are filed, simply they are in record. They are not exhibited. So documents, in my view, can be admitted at interlocutory stage and also during course of trial when it comes to admission of documents as exhibits. Now, the subject documentary evidence may be studied in different points of views. We can study documentary evidence from different points of views. I will take up one view after the other. The first classification of documents may be based on requirement of attestation. That means documents which need no attestation and documents which are compulsorily attestable. This is the first category, category A. What are the documents which are required by law to be attested? Please see Section 63C of the Indian Succession Act, which requires wills to be attested. Testaments have to be attested. Then see Section 59 of the Transfer of Property Act, where a mortgage deed is to be attested where the principal money security is more than 100 rupees. If security is 100 rupees or more, a mortgage deed is compulsorily attestable, section 59 of TP Act. See also section 124 of the TP Act, a gift of immovable property of whatever value can only be made by a registered instrument. That means it is a compulsorily attestable document, and that registered agreement, gift deed according to this section must be attested by at least two witnesses. The fourth one is bond. Please see section 25 of the Indian Stamp Act, which says bond is attestable. But being a judge of the Andhra Pradesh High Court, I will here add a word of caution. In Borisetty Bhavanarayana's case in 1996-1 ALT 917, our full bench held that attestation is not mandatory so far as bond if the other requirements are satisfied. Then the youngsters must know what is attestation. Attestation is defined in section 3 of the Transfer of Property Act. Attestation in relation to an instrument means and shall be deemed always to have meant attested by two or more witnesses, each of whom has seen the executant sign or affix his mark to the instrument, or has seen some other person sign the instrument in the presence and by the direction of the executant, or has received from the executant a personal acknowledgement of his signature or mark, or of the signature of such other person, and each of whom has signed the instrument in the presence of the executant. But it shall not be necessary that more than one of such witnesses shall have been present at the same time, and no particular form of attestation shall be necessary. A comprehensive decision of attestation. Please refer to here Lalita Ben Jayanti Lal's case, Lalita Ben Jayanti Lal Popat's case, 2008, volume 15, Supreme Court cases 365. Then comes when a document like will is sought to be produced, whether an attestor can straight away produce the document, because production and custody of documents is also important. Generally, the document will be produced by propounder, the beneficiary of the document. He will simply mark it for identification's sake. He will exhibit it. Afterwards, the attestor will be examined, because examination of an attestor, at least one attestor, is required to prove a compulsorily attestable document. What is the section? Section 68 of the Indian Evidence Act. It says about proof of execution of document required by law to be attested. Here, I would like to bring to your notice a decision of Janaki Narayan Bohair's case. Janaki Narayan Bohair's case, AR 2003, Supreme Court 761. The law says the compulsorily attestable document must be attested at least by two witnesses. But the law also gives a concession that the document which is required by law to be attested shall not be used as evidence until one attesting witness at least has been examined, provided such witness is available. Section 68. So section 68 gives a concession to those who want to prove and establish an attestable document in a court of law by examining at least one of the two or more attesting witnesses. But here, there is an important word of caution. What is that? The one attestor who is examined must be able to prove attestation by two witnesses. Otherwise, the requirement of proof will not be satisfied. The one attesting witness examined in his evidence has to satisfy the attestation of the compulsorily attestable document by him and also the other attesting witness in order to prove that there was due execution of the will or the compulsorily attestable document. If the attesting witness examined, besides his attestation, does not in his evidence satisfy the requirement of attestation of the document by other witness also, the evidence falls short of attestation of will or the compulsorily attestable document, at least by two witnesses, for the simple reason that the execution of the document does not merely mean the signing of it by testator, but it means fulfilling and proof of all formalities required under law. This is the law laid down in Janaki Narayan Bohair's case, AER 2003, Supreme Court 761. If both the attestors attested at one and the same time, the only witness examined can speak of both the attestations. But if they are examined at different times, then it is difficult to prove attestation by examining one attesting witness only. Therefore, the plaintiff in such cases, or the defendant for that matter, who is relying upon the document to completely adduce evidence. Then section 71 says about the safeguard in regard to mandatory provision under section 68. It says there may be certain situations where it is not possible to prove the execution of compulsory attestable documents by calling an attesting witness, though alive. In such cases, 71 comes to the rescue. So that is how we are now concerned with compulsorily attestable documents. The next classification is primary evidence and secondary evidence. So far as documents are concerned, chapter 5, I was mentioning earlier, section 61 is the relevant section. Section 62 is primary evidence, section 63 is secondary evidence. In my view, when we read the provisions of law, we find that secondary evidence is only of five kinds. What are those five kinds? Certified copies, copies made by mechanical process, and copies compared with such copies. This is the second category. Copies made from or compared with the original, third category. Counterparts of documents. Counterparts means a landlord executes a lease deed. In turn, the tenant also executes a lease deed. Separate documents. Each one is a counterpart. Then oral account of contents of documents given by the persons who have seen it. These are the five kinds of secondary evidence. But importantly, section 65 enumerates seven cases in which secondary evidence can be given. There are five kinds of secondary evidence. There are seven instances in which secondary evidence can be given. What are they? When the original is in the possession of the adversary, the person having possession of the same is out of the reach of the court or not subject to the process of the court. But when the same is in the possession of the opposite party, he doesn't produce it despite a notice to produce document is given. Though he is legally bound to produce it, he withholds it. That is the first category. Second category is existence, condition, and contents of the original are admitted in writing. When an admission is made, please see section 22. Admitted facts need not be proved. Third category is when original is destroyed or lost or cannot be produced. See, the original document is a stone somewhere in Mahabalipuram. How to produce it? Only secondary evidence. Then, the fourth category, when original is not easily movable, like the same illustration. Next, when the original is a public document. So far as public documents are concerned, please also refer to section 74 of the Indian Evidence Act and section 57 of the Indian Registration Act, where public record of private documents is permissible as evidence. That means a CLD is a private document. but its public record is kept in a sub registrar's office. One can obtain a registration extract of that public record and produce it as evidence, namely secondary evidence. It is straight away admissible. Please see section 674 of the Indian Evidence Act and section 57 of the Indian Registration Act. Here I will say words, emphasize on one thing. Every high court is having civil rules of practice. Please, all of you, go through your civil rules of practice of your respective states and also criminal rules of practice. So far as secondary evidence is concerned, in Andhra Pradesh, rule 129 of the civil rules of practice is relevant. Rule 129. Then another category is giving certified copy of the original is permitted. Supposing it's a judgment, certified copy can be obtained and produced. Under the Bankers Book Evidence Act, a certified copy given by a banker can be admitted. Please see section 4 of the Bankers Book Evidence Act. They are verified copies. Then another category is last category G. When the original consists of numerous accounts or other documents, the summary can be adduced as evidence. But this is a class where the originals are available. It is not a case where the original is unavailable. But still, the clause provides for producing evidence as to the general result of the bulky documents. For example, accounts for 10 years, several ledgers and the day books will be there. Books are available, primary evidence is available. But this clause says the result of the all the contents of the account books can be adduced as secondary evidence by appointing an auditor for that matter. He will examine the books and gives a report to the court, which will be a secondary evidence. So I have referred to clauses A to G, which are the seven kinds of documentary secondary evidence, seven instances in which the secondary evidence can be given. But you please see A, C and D dealing with secondary evidence. The secondary evidence of the contents is admissible under A, C and D. Under B, written admission is admissible. Under E and F, certified copy is admissible. In this case, the original is available, but certified copy is permitted to be adduced as evidence. Then clause G, as I already said, evidence as to general result of the case can be, general result of the documents can be adduced as evidence. So please bear in mind all these categories when we are permitting to let in secondary evidence. I request all of you to read Saith Taraji's case, AER 1971 Supreme Court 1865 at your leisure. AER 1971 Supreme Court 1865 at your leisure. And also 2010-9 SCC 712 M. Chandra's case, 2010-9 SCC 712. Regarding secondary evidence, one important aspect we have to bear in mind. Without the original being in existence at some point of time, the question of adducing secondary evidence does not arise. Therefore, a foundation must be laid when secondary evidence is to be adduced. The foundation shall be as to whether the original document is lost or destroyed or is being deliberately withheld by the opposite party, like that, a foundation must be laid. So it is well settled that if a party wishes to lead secondary evidence, the court is obliged to examine the probative value of the document produced in court or their contents and decide the question of admissibility of a document in secondary evidence. So at the same time, the party has to lay down the factual foundation to establish the right to give secondary evidence where the original document cannot be produced. It is equally well settled that neither mere admission of a document in evidence amounts to its proof nor mere marking. So the secondary evidence, the document must also be proved like any other document. Rakesh Mahindra's case, this is the content of Rakesh Mahindra's case, 2016 volume 16 SCC 483. So non-production of original must be accounted for. Non-production of original must be accounted for. Then only secondary evidence is admissible. Please see State of Rajasthan versus KM Raj, 2000, Volume 5, Supreme 125. AER 2000 Supreme Court 1759 is the equivalent. AER 2000 Supreme Court 1759 is the equivalent. State of Rajasthan versus KM Raj. So unless the existence of the original and the inability to produce the original is accounted for, secondary evidence shall not be permitted. Then comes photocopies as secondary evidence. When objection is raised, the procedure required to produce photocopy as a secondary evidence must be followed. When an objection is raised, a photocopy cannot be directly admitted. Because it is secondary evidence procedure must be followed. Please see Shalimar Chemicals case, 2010, volume 8, SCC 423, Supreme Court cases 423. Then the question comes, whether an application shall be filed for permission to adduce secondary evidence. In Dhanpat's case, very recently, 19th March 2020, I do not have the citation. Please note, Dhanpat versus Shioram, rendered by the Supreme Court on 19-3-20. The Supreme Court held there is no requirement that an application is required to be filed in terms of Section 65C of the Evidence Act before adducing secondary evidence. But a party to the list may choose to file such an application. It is not a mandatory requirement. This is the second category. First category is compulsorily attestable documents. Second category is primary evidence and secondary evidence. And then we are coming to the third category. Third category is a bit complex. Under this category, the documents have to be again subclassified. The first category of the subclassification is documents are simple documents which do not require to be charged with duty, which do not require registration. Neither stamp duty is payable nor registration is the requirement. That is the first class. Sir, shall I continue? I have time to continue.
Yes, sir. You have time to continue.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The second category is documents chargeable with duty, subcategory. The third category is documents which require to be charged with duty and also compulsorily registerable. So the third class, class C, we are classifying the documents again into three categories. One is no stamp duty, no registration. The second one is only stamp duty. The third one is stamp duty as well as registration. For these documents also, the rules of evidence are the same. Let us deal with the first subclass. Neither chargeable with duty nor compulsorily registerable. For example, a letter, a postcard written by A to B. The only requirement for marking the document is custody. A wrote a letter to B. The possessor must be B if the letter is delivered. So B is having the custody, he will produce the document. Supposing the letter is undelivered and returned, that a letter is written and undelivered, to prove that the person who has written the letter can be examined. Supposing letter is delivered to B, but B died. His relative or son, like son who is supposed to have the custody of the father's papers, is a competent person to produce the document and mark it. So in this category, except the custody and competency of the witness, nothing else is there to prevent marking of the document or exhibition of the document through a witness. But take a case, a person who is not competent to give certified copies, a person who is not competent to have custody of the record gives copies. Such copies are inadmissible. Such copies are inadmissible. This only aspect we have to bear in mind. Generally, this comes when revenue authorities who are having no competency to issue copies, and they are sought to be marked. So far as the first classification, this is what I wanted to share with you. Please see State of Bihar, AR 1983, Supreme Court 684. Mere marking of a document is not proof. Proof is different from marking. A document may be admissible, may be relevant, but at the same time, the contents may not be proved. Right. The second subclassification, documents which are chargeable with duty. See, very peculiar. When we go to the Indian Stamp Act, such documents are described as instruments. Then what is the difference between a document and instrument? Stamp Act employs the word instrument, Indian Stamp Act. Then let us see what is the difference. Documents mean all material substances on which human thoughts can be recorded. It may be a stone, it may be a wall, it may be a paper. Document is stated in the Indian Evidence Act as to mean all material substances on which human thoughts are recorded. So documents are inanimate proofs. What is an instrument then? Instrument is defined in Indian Stamp Act as under Section 2, Subsection 14. Instrument includes every document by which any right or liability is or purports to be created, transferred, limited, extended, extinguished, or recorded. It deals with rights of the parties either immovable or movable. So documents and instrument are not synonyms. Every instrument is a document, but every document is not an instrument. Supposing a document is chargeable with duty, but on which no duty is paid, is sought to be produced. The judge will not admit that document because the necessary stamp duty is not paid. Similarly, a document is chargeable with a certain duty, but it is not sufficiently charged. Only part of the duty is paid. The judge will not admit the document because it is insufficiently stamped. Please see Ramaratan's case, AER 2001, Supreme Court 1158. The court has to judicially determine whether a document is liable to be charged with duty or not, and if so, whether the duty is paid or not. Otherwise, the court will not admit the document, namely the instrument. Please also see Bipin Shantilal Panchal's case, AER 2001, Supreme Court 1158, of Justice K.T. Thomas and others. Objection relating to deficiency of stamp duty of a document has to be decided then and there. It cannot be postponed unless that objection is decided, the document cannot be permitted to be exhibited. Then which document is liable to be charged with duty? How do we know? We have to go to the schedules of the Stamp Act. Schedule 1 is the central schedule. Schedule 1A is the state schedule. In that a list is given what documents are liable to be charged with duty and what is the duty chargeable. You find the list there. here we have to see not the name given to the document. It may be written as a sale deed, but it may turn out to be a sale agreement. It may be written as a sale agreement as a heading of the document, nomination or nomenclature of the document is sale agreement. But when we go to the body, it appears to be a sale, out and out sale. So we have to see the body, the content of the document to decide what is the nature and character of the document, not the nomenclature. Madras Refineries case, AR 1977 Supreme Court, 500. So you decide the nature and character of the document on the strength of the recitals in the document, on the strength of the recitals in the document, but not the name. Please see section 35 of the Indian Stamp Act, which also says and makes it manifest that no instrument chargeable with duty shall be admitted in evidence for any purpose. For any purpose. Please underline that. For any purpose. Section 33 deals with impounding a document. Impounding means not collection of stamp duty. Impounding means seizure. Simply, the court will seize the document because stamp duty is not paid and a loss is caused to the exchequer. Then comes, what is the procedure? Supposing a document is produced, the court comes to a conclusion on reading the entire document, it is to be charged with duty. The court also notices that it is neither stamped nor sufficiently stamped. Then how to collect? The court will decide what is the stamp duty and then also 10 times the penalty. The court will say that this is a document, you have to pay the stamp duty besides 10 times penalty. Unless you pay both the duty and the penalty, the document will not be admitted. So the party who is interested in getting the document admitted will have to pay the duty as well as the penalty and then exhibit the document. Because it's a fiscal enactment, it is the duty of the court. But then there may be a case after the court determines that this is the stamp duty payable and this is the penalty payable, the party is unwilling to pay the stamp duty and penalty. Therefore, he files an application under section 38(2) of the Stamp Act to refer the document to stamp duty collector for collection of the stamp duty and penalty. The court has no option but to send it to the collector because the collector has a discretion to reduce the penalty, which the court does not have. Please see BVR Reddy's case, AR 1975, AP 96. The ratio in this decision was quoted with approval by Supreme Court in Chilakuri Gangulappa's case, 2001, volume 4, SCC 19. So the court can collect the stamp duty and penalty 10 times if the party is willing to pay. If the party is unwilling to pay and files an application to refer the document to stamp duty collector, the court has no option but to send it to the collector. The collector has a discretion to reduce the penalty, or he may even not collect the penalty in a given case. So the court will send the document to a collector when a party seeks to send it to the collector. Then a case may come. Original is lost. Only copy is available. Original is chargeable with duty, but no duty is paid on the original. Then the question is whether on the secondary evidence, the copy of the document, duty can be collected. The answer is a straight no. No, you cannot collect stamp duty on a copy of a document. Jupiter Kesavarao's case, 1971, 1971 3 SCC 590. Very important case. I request all of you to read it. Here you must also read Raja of Babili's case. It's a Privy Council decision. Raja of Babili, 1900 ILR 23 Madras 49. 1900 ILR 23 Madras 49. Then how duty will be paid? Duty will be paid in the form of adhesive stamps. If the law says, the document can be charged with adhesive stamps, like a promissory note. Adhesive stamps will be affixed to the promissory note. The second category of stamps is impressed stamps. On impressed stamps, sale deed is engrossed, gift deed is engrossed, agreement is engrossed, lease deed is engrossed. The third category is very important. Nowadays, stamp duty can be paid by way of challan. By way of challan in the treasury under the relevant head. Each state has made a state amendment to the Stamp Act to collect stamp duty by way of money through challan. Because of the scam, you are all aware of that, how stamps were forged stamps, fabricated stamps were introduced into the system. Then the next question is, who will pay the stamp duty? See, a lease deed is produced into court. It was signed by both the landlord and tenant. It is a compulsorily, stampable document. It is chargeable with duty. Plaintiff says the defendant will pay. Defendant says the plaintiff will pay. But then the court has to resolve who will pay. Please see section 29 of the Indian Stamp Act, which says duty by whom payable. If there is an agreement between the parties, as per the agreement, who is liable to pay the stamp duty will pay. In the absence of the agreement, the stamp duty is payable by the person mentioned in this section. This is how stamp duty will be collected. Then the next question is, in a suit, the plaintiff pays the stamp duty and penalty also. He succeeds in the suit. He files a costs memo saying that I am entitled to recover as costs the stamp duty and penalty paid also. Whether these costs can be taxed in the decree, that will be the question. Yes, that is what the AP High Court said. J. Kanakachalam's case. Andhra Law Times, page 22, NRC. Please also refer to sections 35, 37, 40 and 41 of the Indian Stamp Act. And also section 44, which says persons paying duty or penalty may recover the same in certain cases. Then a suit is filed on the basis of an agreement of sale for specific performance. No stamp duty is paid on the agreement of sale, though it is stampable. At the stage of numbering of the plaint, on that ground, whether the plaint can be rejected. My view is it cannot be rejected. Payment of stamp duty and penalty arises when the document is tendered in evidence, not when it is filed into court. When it is tendered in evidence. Linkwell Electronics Corporation's case, Linkwell Electronics Limited, 1997 1 law summary 395 1997 1 law summary 395 See, on the ground, a document is inadmissible for want of stamp duty. An objection is raised or not, it is the duty of the court to consider that aspect before the document is permitted to be exhibited. See, in one case, the document is exhibited without collection of stamp duty and penalty. The question is whether the document can be de-exhibited on the application of the aggrieved party. That is, the document can be de-exhibited. See, a document which is chargeable with duty, say for a sale deed. Sale deed is written on a white paper. In a declaration of title suit, that is admitted in evidence as an exhibit. The court failed to discharge its duty and failed to examine whether the document is properly charged with duty or not. Maybe it is advertence, inadvertence, or a mistake, or failure to discharge the duty, or sometimes it is a collusion also. There are such allegations nowadays on the administrative side against judges that he colluded with the other side in the absence of the counsel for the opposite party. The document is permitted to be marked. So the judges must be very careful in these matters. Here I invite your attention to Order 13, Rule 3 of CPC. Rejection of irrelevant or inadmissible documents. The court may at any stage of the suit reject any document which it considers irrelevant or otherwise inadmissible, recording the grounds of such rejection. No doubt, Indian Stamp Act, there is a provision which says document once marked cannot be rejected. But still, there is a provision in CPC. In my view, the document can be de-exhibited. I have rendered a decision to that effect. Please note down AP Lele, A full stop, P full stop, Lele versus Gurram Ram Rao, 2017, 6 ALD 300. 2017, 6 ALD 300. Ranga Murali Krishna Reddy's case, Ranga Murali Krishna Reddy's case, 2018, 5 ALD 396. But another judge of the Andhra Pradesh High Court recently took a contrary view. I'm not having the citation of that decision. Please also look into that aspect. But another learned judge of the Telangana High Court agreed with my view. Judge of the Hyderabad High Court, Telangana High Court, Abdul Rafi versus Abdul Rafoof. Abdul Rafi versus Abdul Rafoof. Versus Venkataya and others. Date of the judgment is 19-6-2019. It is available in India Kanun. India Kanun. Here I will refer to you in support of my humble view, which you may agree with or not. That is my opinion. It's a considered opinion in my view. Please refer to R.V.E. Venkatachal Gowndar's case. R.V.E. Venkatachal Gowndar's case, AER 2003, Supreme Court 4548. R.V.E. Venkatachal Gowndar's case 4548. My view also is supported by one maxim. No party shall suffer for the mistake of a court. By mistake or oversight, an unstamped document is permitted to be exhibited. For that mistake, a party should not suffer. And when there is non-application of mind by a court, the court can always recall the mistake, recall the order, which is the result of a mistake of the court, and then correct its own mistake. These are some of my views. Now I will go back to R. E. Venkatachala Gowda's case. In this case, regarding the admission of documentary evidence, the Supreme Court has classified the objections into categories. There are two categories under this decision. First document is regarding mode of proof. First objection is regarding mode of proof. The second objection is as to admissibility of the document. Where the objection does not dispute the admissibility, but the objection is directed towards only mode of proof, then at the time of exhibiting the document, the objection must be raised. If it is not raised at that stage, it cannot be raised at a later stage. That is what the Supreme Court said. But if the objection relates to inadmissibility, the document which is sought to be proved is itself inadmissible in evidence, then the Supreme Court said the objection can be raised at any later point of time, even in revision or appeal also, even in second appeal also, or at any subsequent stage of the proceeding. So R. V. Venkatachala Gowda's case supports my view that if a document is marked by oversight, mistake or non-application of mind or a collusion, it can be demarked, de-exhibited. But there are different views of different high courts. There is no settled view in the matter till date. This is only my humble opinion. Right. Abdul Rafi's case, I have given already. It is available in India Kanun. The citation is 2019 4 Andhra Legal Decisions, 2019 4 Andhra Legal Decisions 479. Makes an interesting reading. Now we have seen the second category. In the third category, I said there are three subcategories. One is neither stampable with duty nor registerable. The second category, just now we have seen stampable with duty. Now we are going to third category, documents of which registration is compulsory. Please see section 17 of the Indian Registration Act, which gives a list of documents which are compulsorily registerable. If a document is compulsorily registerable and it is not registered, it is an incurable defect. The document cannot be admitted in evidence. Section 18 of the Indian Registration Act deals with documents of which registration is optional. Like, for example, a will, a memorandum of mortgage of deposit of title deeds, a receipt also can be registered. It is optional. Then, on this aspect, there is one more aspect, that is collateral purpose. A document which is compulsorily registerable but not registered, whether it can be admitted for collateral purpose. The straight answer is section 49 of the Indian Registration Act. It can be admitted for collateral purpose. But then there is another complexity. The document is not only compulsorily registerable, but also liable to be, charged with duty, but no duty is payable. Whether it can be admitted for collateral purpose? Yes, provided the stamp duty is collected. Without the document being properly charged with duty, it cannot be admitted for collateral purpose. T. Bhaskar Rao's case, AR 1981 AP 175, which is verbatim approved. The ratio therein was verbatim approved by the Supreme Court. in Yellapu Uma Maheswari's case, Yellapu Uma Maheswari's case, 2015 volume 16, SCC 787, Yellapu Uma Maheswari's case. So if a document is chargeable with duty and is also registerable, but it is not registered and it is not charged with duty, yet it can be admitted for collateral purpose, provided the party pays the stamp duty and penalty, otherwise not. Then the question is, what is collateral purpose? Collateral purpose is other than the main purpose. What is collateral purpose? If you want to understand, you please read K.B. Shah's case. K.B. Saha, AER 2008 Supreme Court Supplement, AER 2008 Supreme Court Supplement 850. In this decision, one important sentence is there. I will read it. If a document is inadmissible in evidence for want of registration, none of its terms can be admitted in evidence, and that to use the document for the purpose of proving an important clause would not be using it as a collateral purpose. Also see Kala Devi's case, AER 2010 Supreme Court 1654. Collateral purpose is other than the main purpose. If a document is inadmissible for want of registration, all its terms are inadmissible for non-registration. Bajaj Auto Limited's case, 1989, Volume 3, Supreme Court Reports, 730. If a lease deed which is compulsorily registrable is not registered, it can be admitted for collateral purpose of showing the nature of possession. That is, the possession is of a tenant. AER 1991 Supreme Court 744. Then another important aspect, with that I will stop. Section 90 of the Indian Evidence Act, presumption as to 30-year-old document. It appears to due execution and attestation, but not to contents. Then the question is whether this 90 presumption can be applied to a copy, not the original. Different high courts have taken different views. The Supreme Court resolved and said 30-year-old presumption applies to the original but not to a copy. Sheetal Das case, AER 1954 Supreme Court 606, AER 1954 Supreme Court 606. Hari Prasad case, AER 1956 Supreme Court 305. Hari Prasad case, 1956 Supreme Court 305. Subbaraju's case, AER 1968 Supreme Court 947. All these cases were referred to in later decision. Siolal's case, SHEO, Siolal, AER 1971 Supreme Court 2342. Then exclusion of oral by documentary evidence. When there is a document, oral evidence cannot be admitted. Gangabhai's case, 1982, one Supreme Court reports, 1176. 1982, one Supreme Court reports, 1176, Gangabhai. See, but supposing the contention is that the deed is not intended to be acted upon, that is admissible as a pleading, as a defense. The suit promissory note is not supported by consideration, it is admissible. then what is the bar? The bar arises only when the document is relied upon, but the terms are sought to be varied. That is what is said in 1982 Supreme Court. Just now I have given 1 SCR 1176. So this is all about documentary evidence. There are many instances in the Indian Evidence Act, which, if permissible, time permits, we will discuss in the interaction. For example, in a title suit, title to property suit, a neighbor is examined. A neighbor who is the owner of a neighboring property is examined as a third party witness. He is not a party to the suit. He is in the box. Can he be asked to produce his document, his title deed to his property? Section 130 says no, he cannot be compelled to produce his document. Likewise, we can discuss many aspects under the relevancy while dealing with the documentary evidence. Likewise, supposing in a compulsory attestable document case, after one attestor is examined, the plaintiff says no further evidence. The defendant cannot insist that the other attestor should be examined. It is for the plaintiff to examine the required number of witnesses, because the section of Indian Evidence Act says it is not the quantity of the evidence, that the quality of evidence and credibility of the evidence that is important. Please see section 134 of the Indian Evidence Act. Likewise, we can discuss many aspects of the Indian Evidence Act under the documentary evidence. Likewise, if a document, compulsorily attestable document, is produced in court, one attestor is examined. The party wants to examine the other attestor also. Then the other counsel may say, cross-examining counsel may say, he will cross-examine both the witnesses at the same time, because he will not be disclosing the line of cross-examination by cross-examining one witness at one point of time and the other at the other point of time, because the other witness will be tutored. So this is one aspect. Another aspect is, when two witnesses come on the same day, the cross-examining counsel may request that when one witness is deposing, the other witness may be kept away from the court hall. So these are all the aspects which a trial court judge must be very conscious. Otherwise, the trial will not be fair. What is a model court according to me? A model court is such court from which court a convicted accused or a losing litigant walks out with a smile and the feeling that he has been fairly dealt with in the system. That is very, very important. Mr. Manish Mohan Garu, I have taken a long time because this is an important subject. There are many more aspects to be covered, I know. But because of the paucity of time, I am confining to only a few aspects. If I feel at the end of the session, there is a value addition to the knowledge banks of the youngsters, I am a very happy man. I know that my interaction is not useful to the elders like you, who are very learned. It is only sharing of my humble thoughts. Thanks to all the organizers and the patient hearing of all of you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir. Wonderful we heard from your lordship, and at least we now know what is expected by judge and advocate in dealing with the case. In fact, with regard to secondary evidence, I suffered a judgment where your lordship rendered a judgment where you said I should lay foundation in the pleadings itself before I claim a document to be secondary evidence. That I will discuss later. We hope to see your lordships again and again on this platform. Now, Mr. Manish Mohan. I request Manish Mohan to take over that.
Sorry, if I have taken more time than.
Not at all, sir.
If your lordship shares with us.
Honorable co-panelist, my Lord Justice M. Sitarama Murthy, Chairman of the Andhra Pradesh Human Rights Commission, Sir, it was a pleasure listening to you. And honestly speaking, I feel jealous of youngsters present today who are so privileged to hear you so early in their career. I wish I was so lucky myself. The organizers of today's seminar, talk show, whatever we can say, Yagna Legal, and the names behind it, Mr. Bhaskar Poluri, Mrs. Shridevi Jampani, who happened to be my eminent colleagues at the bar, and last but not the least, Mr. Jupudi. Dear student, dear guests, a very good morning to all of you. I cannot but agree to what my Lord Justice Murthy just now said. The subject law of evidence is very elastic, and the elasticity can be explained by me only one sentence. I have revised Lal Dhirilal's Law of Evidence, the paper book edition, which is of 800 odd pages, and I have also revised Woodruff and Nannicelli's Law of Evidence, which is of 4 volumes with 1800 to 1900 pages each. Secondly, I also want to
Am
I audible?
Now you are audible.
Now you are audible, Manish.
This rule of prudence, I would refer to Sir James Fitzstephens, who was the author of Indian Evidence Act of 1869, and who evidence bill would be short. It would consist of only one rule to this effect, that all rules of evidence are hereby abolished. So that is the best statement
sir, the link is failing.
Some problem with the link.
Yes sir, there is a problem with the link.
Problem with the link. Hopefully
too many.
So that is the statement of Sir James Fitzstephens, that all rules of evidence are hereby abolished, is the best statement to refer to the rule of prudence that is so important in the law of evidence. Let me start with the basic provision of Indian Evidence Act, Section 3. Which defines documents. It says, document means any matter expressed or described upon any substance by means of letter, figure, or mass. So, just what is there on paper, it can be
Manish.
He please ask all the remaining participants to unmute.
It is muted, sir.
All are muted, okay. Except the speaker, all others may be muted. Let him unmute.
Now you are unmuted.
Hopefully. So, I was referring to Section 3 of the Evidence Act. It refers to matters expressed or described upon any substance, not only papers. It can be on any substance. For example, a logo of a tire is also a document. We generally have in my mind, in our mind, of documents means instruments or contracts or letters or these things. But the word document has a very vast meaning and includes any letter, figure or mark expressed on upon any substance. So the examples of Section 3 illustrations are very clear. Writing is a document, words printed, lithographed or photographed are documents, a map is also a document, a caricature, an inscription on a metal plate, all these are documents. An essential component of the law of evidence is that in all cases, it is the best proof or the best evidence which ought to be given. By this best evidence rule, it is meant that if the primary evidence exists, then the secondary evidence won't be applicable. So where the demonstration of proof is shown by way of a record, the record is the best evidence of reality. Oral evidence has lesser value than documentary evidence because of two reasons. Firstly, the oral evidence can be improved upon with passage of time and therefore it falls within the suspicious category. Secondly, oral evidence also requires corroboration for its acceptance. So there are few very important issues related to documentary evidence. And according to me, they are the following issues. First is how to prove a document. Second is how much necessary it is to examine the author of a document. Third is the documentary evidence dependent upon oral evidence? Fourth is whether the contents of a document are also required to be proved. And the fifth is, what if there is a conflict between documentary evidence and oral evidence? So these are some of the issues which I'll be explaining with reference to the provisions of Indian Evidence Act, because that is something which we all must necessarily fall back upon to wriggle out of a situation in a professional life, in a professional career, or even for students. So the first issue is how to prove a document. Now, Section 64 of the Evidence Act is titled Proof of Documents by Primary Evidence. It says documents must be proved by primary evidence except in cases herein after mentioned. What are those cases? Those cases are mentioned in Section 65. They are the cases of secondary evidence. Section 65 says secondary evidence may be given of the existence, condition, and contents of a document in the following cases. The cases have been described A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So, the section itself says that in the cases of A, B, and D, any evidence of the contents of document is admissible. In case B, the written admission is admissible. In case E to F, a certified copy of a document, but no other kind of secondary evidence is admissible. In case G, evidence may be given as to the general result of the documents by any person who has examined them and who is skilled in the examination of such documents. As Justice Murthy had very rightly said, these are the different conditions where secondary evidence can be led. Now, these are the conditions A to G, which we must place before the Honorable Court by way of pleading one way or the other, be it in the part of the written plaint, written statement, replication, or through an application. But such a pleading has to be before the Honorable Court so that it can be, secondary evidence can be adduced. Now, the third section relevant for this issue is Section 67. How to prove a document. Section 67 is very important because it speaks of proof of signature and handwriting of persons alleged to have written or signed or written document which is produced. If a document is alleged to be signed or to have been written wholly or in part by any person, the signature or the handwriting of so much of the document as is alleged to be in that person's handwriting must be proved to be in his handwriting. So that is also a way of proving a document. And the last provision which I'll refer to, which is relevant, is Section 68. Section 68 says, it deals with proof of execution of document required by law to be attested. It reads, if a document is required by law to be attested, it shall not be used as evidence until one attesting witness at least has been called for the purpose of proving its execution. If there be an attesting witness alive and subject to the process of the court and if he is capable of giving witness. There is also a proviso. So, to summarize on the issue of how to prove a document, I'll say the following. First is, a document can be proved by leading primary evidence. Second is, in the absence of primary evidence, a document can be proved by leading secondary evidence, Section 65. After fulfilling the legal requirements for leading secondary evidence. Third is, the signature or the handwriting on the document which is sought to be proved must also be proved, Section 67. And fourth is, if the document sought to be proved is one that is required to be attested, then not all, but at least one person who is an attesting witness should step into the witness box and depose regarding the execution of the document in question. So this is how a document is to be proved in court. Now I'll come to the second issue. The second issue is how much necessary it is to examine the author of a document. Now in this issue, on this issue, the Honorable Supreme Court has held that proof of the authorship of a document is proof of a fact. Authorship is not related to documentary evidence. It is a fact of execution and of authorship. And therefore, like any other fact, the evidence relating thereto may be direct or circumstantial. So with regard to authorship, the evidence has to be oral. It can be either direct evidence or circumstantial evidence. However, to hold that a document is not admissible for proof of its content unless the writer is called is to denude documentary evidence of all its value and is clearly contrary to certain express statutory provisions to be found in the Indian Evidence Act, to which I will presently refer. Documentary evidence becomes meaningless if the writer has to be called in every case to give oral evidence of its content. that is not even allowed. I'll refer to it later. If that were the position, it would mean that in the ultimate analysis, all evidence must be oral, and that oral evidence would virtually be the only kind of evidence recognized by law. However, this is not the position in Indian Evidence Act. We have just seen Section 67, under which the signature or the handwriting of the document sought to be proved is required to be proved. In addition, we have Section 73, which speaks of comparison of signature, writing, or seal with others admitted or proved. So, Section 73 reads, in order to ascertain whether a signature, writing, or seal is that of the person by whom it purports to have been written or made, any signature, writing, or seal admitted or proved to the satisfaction of the court to have been written or made by that person may be compared with the one which is to be proved. Although the signature, writing, or seal has not been produced or proved for any other purpose. So I think a phrase which should have been mentioned here is, according to me, previously admitted or proved to the satisfaction of the court. Which means that in one proceeding, if a handwriting or signature or seal is proved to belong to person A, then we don't need to prove it again before another court. That piece of evidence which is an admitted evidence in court A in a proceeding different can be produced before the court B. And by sheer reference to that, the handwriting or signature or seal can be taken to be admitted in terms of Section 73. The court may direct any person present in court to write any words or figures for the purpose of enabling the court to compare the words or figures so written with any word or figure alleged to have been written by such person. This section also applies with necessary modification to fingerprints, to thumb impressions. So if in a given situation there is a person present in court, and the question is whether this document was authored by him, whether it was signed by him, or whether it was witnessed by him, the very simple thing which a court can do is ask the person to come and sign it or to write it or to inscribe his thumb impression before the court. And once that is done, it gets established. So to summarize about this second issue, that is the necessity of examining the author of a document, I'll summarize that first, a document can be proved by examining its author, either in terms of Section 67, by the author stepping into a witness box, or two, a document can be proved on the basis of previously proved signature, or then proved signature, writing, or seal of the author. So that takes care of the second question about the necessity to examine the author of a document. Now let me come to the third issue. Is the documentary evidence dependent on oral evidence? Because this is something which, as a student of law, even I had in my mind. What is the use of documentary evidence if everything has to come down to oral evidence? But that was when I was a beginner. Things are much deeper and much wider in that sense. So therefore, I'm flagging it as an issue. Is the documentary evidence dependent on oral evidence? Now, as seen while dealing with the first two issues, documentary evidence is dependent on oral evidence to the extent of Sections 67, 68, 73. Basic oral evidence is must for laying down the foundation after which the documentary evidence can be taken by the court. So that takes care of this issue which is important but very short. Section 67, 68, and 73 are the necessary provisions. And once the basic overall evidence is adduced before the court, then the documentary evidence can do wonders for you as a counsel or the litigant if it is in your favor. That is very important. Now let me come to the fourth issue. Whether the contents of a document are also required to be proved. This is an issue. This is an issue. Even though we have Section 69, which specifically lays down, it reads, proof of facts by oral evidence. The section is, all facts except the contents of documents or electronic records may be proved by oral evidence. So therefore, in terms of Section 59, only oral evidence is to be led for all facts except the contents of a document or electronic record. As far as the contents of a document or electronic record is concerned, oral evidence is not required. Then let me refer to Section 61 of the Indian Evidence Act. It speaks of proof of contents of document. It reads, the contents of documents may be proved either by primary or by secondary evidence. Now, what is primary evidence? Section 62. Primary evidence means the document itself produced for the inspection of the Honorable Court. So if the original document is produced before the Honorable Court for its inspection before the adversary, so that the adversary can also see the document, then that is more than sufficient and contents need not be proved. Now there is an explanation also to Section 62 which says that where a document is executed in several parts, each part of that is a primary evidence of the document. If there are part A, part B, part C, part D, then there may be four parts of a document, but for the purpose of court and for the purpose of record, for the purpose of evidence, they are four primary documents. So where a document is executed in counterpart, each counterpart being executed by one or some of the parties only, each counterpart is primary evidence as against the parties executing it. For example, we can say a document is agreed to not directly when parties are sitting in front of each other, but over letter. So there can be two documents creating an agreement or a contract. Document A is a letter written by party A. Document B is a letter written by party B. And both are relevant for the purposes of proving an agreement or a contract. So that is a case of two different documents, two different piece of documents creating one whole contract. Similarly, there is another explanation where the number of documents are all made by one uniform process. There are illustrations also to Section 62 about primary evidence. Now let us come again to secondary evidence. Section 63. A secondary evidence means and includes certified copies given under the provisions herein after contained. Similarly, copies made from the original by mechanical process, like a Xerox copy. All these are secondary evidence. Three is copies made from or compared with the original. So if a copy made from the original is compared Xerox copies are a recent invention. Previously, they were documents were handwritten and compared, and there, according to that, it was a secondary evidence were created. There are illustrations also to section 63. So to summarize on this issue, contents of a document is also required to be proved. I'll summarize two ways. Firstly, the facts other than contents of a document are to be proved only. That is section 59. And then second, the contents of a document automatically get proved by primary evidence under section 62 or secondary evidence under section 63. Once the document gets proved, so you need not prove the contents of a document. You only prove the document by primary or secondary evidence. The contents automatically get proved. So let me come to the fifth issue. What if there is a conflict between documentary and oral evidence? We have already seen that only the document is required to be proved by leading oral evidence regarding the execution of document. Second, the contents of any document is not required to be proved. And to that extent, section 53, 59 acts as a bar. However, there can be still situations where there is a conflict between the oral evidence and the documentary evidence. And I'll refer to such conflicts. Rather, I should refer to it immediately. Take, for example, there is an agreement to sell. What is written in the agreement is that time is the essence of the contract. But thereafter, one party says, no, time was not the essence of the contract. So section 91 deals with such situations, where the oral evidence is something different from what the document says. Section 91 of the Act lays down that when the terms of a contract or grants or other depositions of the property is reduced as a document, then no evidence is required to be given for proof of those matters except in the document itself. There are two exceptions to these provisions. First is when a public officer is required by law to be appointed in writing and any officer has acted as such, the writing need not to be proved. The second exception is will admitted to probate in India may be proved by the probate. In the case of Tulsi versus Chandrika Prasad, that is, note down the citation, AIR 2006, Supreme Court 3359, Tulsi versus Chandrika Prasad, I'm repeating, AIR 2006, Supreme Court 3359. The Honorable Supreme Court has held that Section 91 does not prohibit the parties to adduce some evidence in case the deed is capable of being construed differently for proving the way they understood. So, it can be a different situation where oral evidence is being used to contradict the documentary evidence. But oral evidence, according to this judgment, Tulsi versus Chandrika Prasad, rendered by Honorable Supreme Court, oral evidence can be laid in a situation where the parties have to explain that a certain contract or certain agreement was understood by them, that is he and others, in a particular way. In a different way from the other opponent party. On the other hand, Section 92 further excludes the evidence of oral agreements. Section 92 says that after the document has been produced to prove its terms under Section 91, the provisions of Section 92 is triggered for the purpose of excluding evidence of any oral agreement or statement for the purpose of contradicting, varying, adding, or subtracting from its terms. There are six provisos to this section. Proviso 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So as can be seen from the above discussion, when the terms of the contract or grants or other dispositions of property is reduced in writing as a document and sought to be proved by, as primary document, as documentary evidence, then the oral evidence is not allowed to contradict it. After a document has been proved or rather produced to prove its terms under section 91, the provisions of section 92 come and exclude evidence of any oral agreement or statement for the purpose of contradicting, varying, adding, or subtracting from its terms. Here I can again give a practical example about contents of a document. Again, specific performance suit. Now, in case of specific performance suit, where there is an agreement to sell, the plaintiff who has come to court needs to prove their agreement to sell, because he is relying on that agreement to sell to get the agreement specifically enforced. Now let us assume for a moment there are two clauses in that agreement to sell. One is that time is the essence of contract. Second is of forfeiture. So the onus of proving, the court may put on the defendant for proving these issues, that whether time is the essence of contract, there was a forfeiture permissible in the contract or in the agreement between the parties. So here is a situation where the plaintiff has to prove the agreement to sell before the honorable court. These two issues are only issues taken by defendant in defense, that time was the essence and the plaintiff had not performed the, was not had come forward with the necessary requirements within a specific time frame, or that there was a forfeiture clause. So once the document stands framed, when the document stands exhibited and admitted, contents automatically get admitted. So therefore, one has to be very cautious of this thing, that the document, once it is taken on record, it is exhibited, it is admitted by the court, the contents automatically get proved. So the defendant need not lead any evidence to prove that there was a forfeiture clause or there was time was the essence. These things stand proved, but the document stand proved. So therefore, section 59 clearly says the document is on record, contents need not be proved. Once the document is admitted and these provisions are there in the agreement to sell, then the defendant's duty to liability to the onus, rather the defendant's onus to prove these issues regarding his defense stands proved. So this was a brief landscape under the Indian Evidence Act for a documentary evidence to be introduced, to be led, or to be dealt with. Now, once again, and I don't have an option to agree to all these eternal truths, Justice Murthy had very rightly said at the very beginning that ours is a field of continuous learning. And I say this to almost all my interns, and I can see quite a handful of them attending this conference or seminar. I always tell my interns also, my juniors also, that while they come to me with the expectation to learn something, I am smarter than them. I'll end up learning much more from them. So within the profession, we must all try to learn with every experience, with every opportunity, and with every thing that comes in our hand. And that is a must. That is how we grow in the profession, and that is a must. So lastly, about the documentary evidence, I'll say one thing which I have purposefully missed out, so that I can say in the end. Where any document which is sought to be introduced as evidence is an electronic document, then the same will have to meet the requirements as prescribed under the Information Technology Act. And we have so many of them in the Evidence Act itself. Like, for example, when 67 is there, we can also have read section 67A. All these are there and they can be referred to for electronic documents. And they are almost parallel to the main provision with regard to documents. Now, another important thing which I should also refer here is about section 58 of the Evidence Act. Rather say that section 58 of the Evidence Act is one of the most ignored provision of Indian Evidence Act. But today, when we have so much of litigation, the entire judicial system stands choked. We can refer to section 58. I'll just quote section 58. It says, no fact need to be proved in any proceeding which the parties thereto or the agents agree to admit at the hearing, or which before the hearing they agree to admit by any writing under their hands, or which by any rule of pleading in force at the time they are deemed to have admitted by their pleadings. So it can be by the Honorable Court suo motu, or by way of an application by either of the parties, that they should invite the other party to come forward and speak out whether they are admitting certain facts or not. That will resolve many of the issues which otherwise consume so much of time in proving, which is not required. The parties are directly or indirectly admitting it. For example, in a suit for specific performance, which I'm repeatedly saying by way of example, the agreement to sell, if it is an admitted document, end of the matter. Why should a party prove it when the defense is also, defendant is also relying upon the contents of that agreement to sell? But then what we invariably see is that in every case for specific performance, there is so much of effort put in to prove an agreement to sell, which can be dispensed with by referring to section 58. So I'll say that lawyer's strategy at the very initial stage of a case is very important. Because ultimately, at the very inception of a case, based on whatever the pleadings or whatever the documents on record, if you don't work out a strategy for yourself, then we cannot be guided by word of mouth, number one. And number two, for a litigant also who come to me midway during a trial asking me to step in, I generally advise them not to change the commander in the middle of fight. Because the strategy which counsel A must have thought of and done so many things may not be in the mind of counsel B or whoever is the replacement. So therefore, at the very inception, a counsel needs to have a strategy with regard to a litigation strategy must not be only limited to pleadings, but also to how evidence is to be led, what evidence is to be led, and therefore changing the commander midway or changing the council midway can result in mishaps. That's all which I have to say. Thank you all. Once again, thank you, Justice Murthy, for laying down so succinctly the foundation on which I could speak further. Wish you all a very, very happy Independence Day in advance. And also wish you a very great weekend ahead. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Manish.
And now, with permission, I will add a few things for the benefited juniors. Is it permissible?
Yes, sir. Yes, my lord.
Please.
So far as the scheme regarding proof of documents, for the youngster's sake, I will deal with certain aspects. Proof of a signature, it was referred to by learned Manish ji, 67 of the Indian Evidence Act. It is by calling a person who signed or wrote a document. That is the first possibility. The second possibility is by calling a person in whose presence the document was signed or written. If it is signature, if it is signed, if it is written. Then third chance is by calling a handwriting expert, section 45. The fourth possibility is by calling a person acquainted with the handwriting or the signature, section 47. Then, as rightly pointed out by learned Manish ji, section 73, comparison by the court. Either the court comparing with the admitted signatures or by signature taken in open court at the instance of the court. Similarly, writing. Then by proof of admission. This is how the document can be proved. Signature can be proved. But then there are certain sections which deal with the section 61 onwards. I'll categorize these sections for youngsters into three categories. Please, youngsters who are interested, may note down. How contents of documents are to be proved, section 61 to 66. How contents of documents are to be proved, section 61 to 66. How document is proved to be genuine, 67 to 78. Genuineness, 67 to 78. Presumptions as to documents, section 79 to 90. This is how we can classify and group these sections. Please bear in mind. Then another important aspect I would like to add is, a document is written, it is marked, but the contents can be disproved, dehorse the document. I'll illustrate. See, A is the owner of the property, but B, claiming himself to the owner of the property, executes a sale deed in favor of C. B is not the owner. The document is exhibited, no doubt. But A can always prove, dehorse the contents of the document, that B is not the owner. A is the owner, because the law says, no one can convey a better title than what he possesses. So certainly, dehorse the contents of the document, the incorrectness of the contents of the document can be proved. Like for example, A is the wife of B. In a document, it is described, A is the wife of C. Can't A prove that it is a wrong content? Similarly, a will is executed. A will is executed mentioning a property of the wife as belonging to the executant, the testator. The wife can always say, divorce the contents of the will, that she is the owner and her husband cannot will away her property. And therefore, the recital in the will is invalid and cannot be enforced. So likewise, there are instances where the contents of the document can be proved to be incorrect, divorce the document. Say a 90-year-old document, a 30-year-old document under Section 90, 30-year-old document under Section 90. Genuinely, A executed a document 30 years back in favor of B, but the property that was conveyed is Taj Mahal. The presumption applies only to execution and the attestation, but not to the contents. Otherwise, B will be the owner of the Taj Mahal. So that is why the presumption is carefully worded by employing a very correct language, that the presumption extends only to execution and the attestation, but not to the contents. So there are many such instances where the proof of contents of documents is something different from mere exhibiting. That is why I have given a decision that the contents of a document can be divorced, the contents therein be proved to be wrong, incorrect. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, my lord. Now the time for the questioner is, people who is having the questions, they can raise the hands so that we will call one by one.
In fact, in the chat box, I received a question. One Mr. Ramakrishna, Tulsi Ram, these three questions are, confrontation of evidence can be marked. Confrontation evidence...
Sir, I can ask myself if you don't mind.
Yes, please.
Is that okay, sir?
Okay, sir.
Tulsi Ram gar, you can ask your question.
Yes, Millard, one question. In American courts, mostly confrontation evidence play a major role. But when it comes to Indian courts, the confrontation evidence has very minimal. So to admit confrontation evidence during my cross-examination, do I need to first admit the other side witness to the photograph or the signature or something else in my document in order to get it marked? That is the question. And please run with an example.
No, please repeat your question. What is confrontation evidence? What is the evidence you have to, that is, you want to put it to the witness in the cross-examination? Please, you give the illustration. Give me an illustration of what is the confrontation evidence.
I want to bring all of a sudden piece of evidence which is going to change the decision of the court, and where in which that evidence I have not listed either in the list of documents in the plaint, in the list of documents.
As I already said, if it is a document, you can confront to the witness any document in the cross-examination without permission of the court also. You need not produce it with the prior permission. All of a sudden, you can take out from your pocket, court pocket, a document and confront the witness. And then if he is concerned with the document, he will answer the questions. Supposing he is a total stranger to the document, then you are not naturally entitled to put any questions on the document to a total stranger. He must be concerned with the document.
I got that. How to make it marked, Millard, at that time? How to make it marked?
See, A is in the witness box. He says that his thumb impressions are not available anywhere, he says. Then you ask him in the cross-examination, are you a government employee? He says, yes. At the time of joining service, you have given thumb impressions of both, five fingers of both hands in the service register. He says, yes. You have already summoned with the permission of the court from his office. The service register, it is available, having been summoned by you. With the permission of the court, you take the summoned service register and show it to him, and that this document contains your thumb impressions, that your evidence that you never gave thumb impressions is false. He admits it. The document is marked. That is confrontation. Is it not? So you must take care to see that the document is already summoned and available in the court. Otherwise, when there is some content in the document, the witness is not supposed to speak of the contents of the document. He must only produce the document. He will also give you the relevant section of law in the Evidence Act if it is readily available with me. A is speaking of some contents of a document, but he suppresses the fact that what he is speaking of is contained in a document. The intelligent cross-examining counsel in the cross-examination brings about the truth, stating that what all you have now stated is contained in a document, is it not? The witness is compelled to say yes. All his oral evidence without production of the document is inadmissible and is not relevant under Section 144 of the Indian Evidence Act. The document ought to be produced. He cannot suppress the document and lead evidence by giving contents of the document. So it all depends upon the counsel's ability to cross-examine and bring the truth on record.
Only two things I wish to add here. Even if while cross-examining a witness, if you are referring to or confronting a witness with any document, then the courts usually mark that document. Once marked, the document becomes a part of the record. But it is advisable to use such documents to prove your case, because the cross-examination has the limited purpose of discrediting the witness. So if you want to prove your case on the basis of your cross-examination, that is a wrong strategy. Keep yourself confined to cross-examination only for the purpose of discrediting the witness. Thank you so much.
Sir, I will add, being for some time a trial court judge, one more aspect. Supposing only signature is admitted when document is confronted in cross-examination, the judge will take care to mark only the signature.
Yes.
Signature, and not the entire document.
Not the entire document.
So that is how trial court judges must be trained in the academy.
Yes. Generally, the marking is X to X.
X to X. That's
X to Y.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The two versions are bench and bar.
Yes, sir.
No.
The advocate must also be alert. They should caution the judge that he is only admitting the signature, not the contents. The contents are not put to the witnesses, so therefore the signature alone be marked. And when a document is confronted and it is not also admitted, we suggest that the document must be filed with a memo into court. Tomorrow, if the another witness comes and admits the document, we don't know what was the document earlier confronted to the earlier witness, whether it is the same document or not. So the trial court judges must be trained in all these aspects. A document is confronted in the cross-examination to the witness, it does not admit it. Still, it must be filed with a memo into court. Tomorrow, it may be confronted to some other witness. It should not remain with the counsel.
In fact, as a lawyer, the challenge is twofold. First is what not to speak, and second is what must mandatorily be spoken.
Okay.
Thank you.
If silence is sometimes better than the words you speak, better you keep silent. And the last word in argument in always is silence.
Silence.
Keeping quiet.
I remember the golden words by trial court judge once upon a time told me, one advocate should know what are to be questioned and what not to be questioned.
Many things, sir. Evidence Act is complete. It's a complete guide. A witness is summoned to produce a document. Only produce a document. Counsel in court says, I will cross-examine him. The judge will get a doubt whether to permit or not. If the judge is thorough with the Evidence Act, 139 says, no, the permission cannot be granted. Then he is only summoned to produce a document. So the judge must be thorough with all provisions of the Indian Evidence Act, particularly provisions relating to relevancy and admissibility.
Very true. Very true. Any more questions?
With permission, I do have one more question. Millard, I have one question. Section 91 of CRPC and Order 11, Rule 12 of CPC versus Section 65 of Indian Evidence Act. Either in the criminal court or in the civil court, when I don't have either the photocopy or the original of a document, but I know the document is in the possession of authority or other party. Presently, this 91 and Order 11, Rule 12, is it not a mandate on the courts, I mean, to admit the application, petition filed by the either plaintiff or accused?
Sir, this Murthy will explain better because the question is addressed to the other side. But from a lawyer's perspective, I can only say that before such a situation arises, one must ensure that there is sufficient pleading on record so as to compel the court to grant necessary indulgence in such a situation.
So, Section 6.
Non-application of provisions of the CPC, please see. Order 10, Order 11, Order 12 are never put into use. Order 10 is examination of parties by the court, either before framing of issues or at the time of framing of charges. 313 says a file with accused can be examined at any time. Then discovery and inspection. You are talking about discovery. Discovery and inspection. Then is admission. See, in our Kakinada court, though it's a Mufassil court, we always used to give notice to admit documents before we proceeded to trial. If documents are admitted, then it will reduce the volume of evidence. So likewise, we can also ask the parties regarding discovery also. But as you rightly said, are you having CPC with you?
Yes, I do, sir. I do.
Go to our Rule 12.
Yes, Rule 12.
Please read proviso.
I am on Rule Order 12.
Order 11, Rule 12, proviso.
Order 11, Rule 12. Provided that discovery shall not be ordered when and so far as the court shall be of opinion that it is not necessary either for disposing fairly of the suit or for saving cost.
So it shall be ordered when it is necessary for fairly disposing of the matter. If the discovery is not necessary to fairly dispose of the matter, the court will not order the discovery. So it all the discretion of the court and depends upon the facts and circumstances of the case as to whether at the request of a party or an accused, a particular evidence be called, a particular evidence be discovered. Like, for example, you seek the court to inspect the scene of offense.
Mm-hmm.
Scene of offense, saying that from the point from where the alleged eyewitnesses is standing, it is impossible to see the scene of offense, is your contest. It's a discovery. The court may inspect and stand at the same tree where the eyewitness allegedly student sees, and whether it the court also comes to a conclusion whether it is possible to see the offense being committed from that point. So there may be so many illustrations. It all depends on facts and circumstances of each case. So examination of parties to narrow down the issues, discovery and inspection, even discovery of documents also is spoken to in Rules 1 to 11. Rule 15 says inspection of documents of the opposite parties which are voluminous. And Rule 16 says notice to produce documents. Suppose one document contains a recital regarding a previous antecedent document. You can give a notice to produce the antecedent document also. Or you can obtain a registration extract and file it if the other side does not produce it. That gives a right to produce secondary evidence because the original is not produced despite notice. So inspection of documents referred to in pleading or affidavits is permissible under Rule 15. Notice to produce is there. Order for inspection can be passed by the court. Verified copies can be given to the parties. And then the Rule 21 says non-compliance with discovery. If the there is non-compliance, what are the consequences are stated in Rule 21? And then you can serve interrogatories and seek answers. How interrogatories must be sought and answered are contained in rules of practice. And this order, a peculiarity of this order is, this order applies even to minors. We are not putting to use all these important provisions, otherwise the trial court's recording of evidence volume of work will be reduced.
Rightly said.
Very nice, and Bhaskar Garu, very rarely we find interactions. But in this session, we have some interaction.
There is a question for Manish. Give some suggestions on re-examination.
See, initially, I wanted this examination, cross-examination, re-examination to be a very separate topic for a separate session. But still, now that the question has cropped up, I won't mind. Re-examination has its own limitations. And the limitation is that only certain things which have cropped up in the cross-examination can be explained by the witness by way of re-examination. Re-examination cannot be used to add up to the evidence already tendered until unless that becomes a necessity based because of certain questions asked in cross-examination. So re-examination is one thing which depends totally upon the court. If the court, honorable court, deems it proper, and if the counsel is able to satisfy the honorable court with regard to the need for a re-examination, that can be allowed by the honorable court. But if the honorable court is not satisfied, then honorable court can also decline re-examination. So what is important is that if you feel like seeking re-examination of your witness, then you must make out a case based on certain questions put to your witness in the cross examination, saying that this was the question and I want to explain it further. I want the witness to get an opportunity to explain it out further, and therefore re-examination is necessary. At the same time, if you are the other counsel who had cross-examined the witness, then you must satisfy the Honorable Court why the witness is wanting an extra opportunity to wriggle out of a contradiction which you were able to extract from the witness by way of your cross-examination. So much about the re-examination depends upon the Honorable Court. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Manish. With this discussion, we are ending this present day topic, and we will continue the same set of seminars in the future. On behalf of EGNA Legal and on behalf of all the participants, I thank the panelists, Honorable Justice Sri Mandata Sitaram Murthy and Mr. Manish Mohan for accepting our invitation and sharing their knowledge of law. We thank all the participants in the webinar, including senior advocates and judicial officers. We will be organizing series of webinars, and this is the beginning and second of the series. We will be uploading this webinar on the official YouTube channel for the better understanding of the today's topic. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much. We are also immensely benefited. We learned a lot.
Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure interacting with learned people, and it was Mr. Murthy, Justice Murthy, who enlightened us about the practical aspect of law of evidence. We look forward to more such opportunities. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Take leave, sir. Take leave.
Thank you. Thank you.